Hello again. So this is a video where I will introduce kernel density estimators. And that is a method which generalizes what we just did in the section about histograms. So the aim is still estimate the density based from data, but it is a more general method and it allows to get continuous estimators if you want to. And it takes out some of the choices you need to make with the histograms. So instead of having to choose all the buckets, we will see you just need to choose one parameter, which will be the bandwidth. So let's jump straight in. Okay, so what we've just seen is when we scale the histogram bar so that we hope they estimate the density function, then the height of bucket I, hi, should be given by that. So let me just write this out again. So if x is in some interval, let's just write ab so that I don't need to write these subscripts, then the histogram estimates the density at x as, and I just write f hat of x here, f hat being an estimate of f. And now we need to just copy what I've written. So it's 1 over n width of the interval, which is b minus a. And then the count, so sum I from 1 to n, indicator function, and now I just called it a and b of xi. So that's the formula we just had, only with slight change of notation. Good, and I want to rewrite that a bit. So the first thing I want to do is I put the 1 over b minus a here to go with the indicator function. Good. Then there is a slightly annoying point that the a and b here depend on the x, because it says here x must be in the interval from a to b. A and b are the boundaries of some bucket. So if I change x, it may be in a different bucket, so I may have different a and b. So that is a bit, has a risk of getting things wrong. So we need to do something here. And that is the first change which is made for kernel density estimation compared to histograms. Then the buckets are no longer fixed, but instead, to make sure that we always have a bucket which contains x, we just center them around x. So what I do here now is, instead of a fixed interval AB, we center the interval around x. Say we use the interval x minus h up to x plus h. Then we can still choose h for the width, but x is now right in the middle. So what we get is then, it's a different f hat now, I just use the same symbol because we do more steps and only at the end we get our estimator. So f hat x is, with the new way of doing things, 1 over n, sum a from 1 to n, and then we need the width of the interval, that is now b minus a is x plus h minus x minus h is x plus h minus x plus h is 2h, the x cancel. Good, so that's 1 over 2h. And then here, where we have the indicator function, we just need to write the correct a and b. So here, indicator function of x minus h up to x plus h of xi. And just to be sure, let me be explicit about that. We center the interval around x, which is the point where we are estimating the density. X has nothing to do with the data, so we are not centering around one of the data points xi. We are centering it around the x where we are estimating the density. Later we will, of course, look at different x and let x move so that we can estimate the whole density as a function. But again, that interval is not centered around the data points. It is still fixed in the sense once we have chosen where do we want to estimate the density, we just pick our bucket so that x is bang on in the middle. Then I want to rewrite that a bit further. So that's 1 over n, sum I from 1 to n, 1 over 2h, indicator function, and I move the x into the argument, so I can say minus h to plus h here, if here I write xi minus x, and that is true because if xi minus x is between minus h and plus h, then xi itself, it's larger by x, is then in x minus h to x plus h. And finally, I want to pull out the h as much as possible, so then we can write 1 over n, sum I from 1 to n, and then let's here have the 1 over h separately, and then I write 1 half indicator function minus 1 to plus 1. And I can do that if I instead divide by h here, xi minus h divided by h. So same logic as it was with the shift from here to here. If I divide both the numbers in here and the argument by h, then that indicator function takes the value 1 if and only if that one takes the value 1. And the reason I'm doing this is I want to now give a name to that function. So if we write k of x for 1 half indicator function minus 1 up to plus 1 of x, then we get f hat of x is 1 over n sum I from 1 to n 1 over h k of xi minus x over h. And for a reason you will see in a second, there is one more substitution I want to make. Namely, I want to do this rescaling with h also as a shorthand for a function k which goes from R to R. Let kh be the rescaled function, rescaled as 1 over h k x over h. And then f hat suddenly looks very simple. So that's 1 over n sum I from 1 to n kh of xi minus x. This here is actually the form the quantum density estimates we will consider will take. And the only change we need to make at this stage is the only other change. The first change was we centered the intervals, the bucket around x. The only other change is the kernel density estimate allows more general functions k here. So in our case, k is this. But it turns out this expression also works and makes sense for different functions k. And in particular, if you plug in continuous functions, you will get continuous estimates. And there is much freedom to play here. And the result, if you allow general k, is called the kernel density estimate. So let me just write that down. So let k from R to R be given such that, and now I need a few properties, namely k of x needs to be positive and k should be symmetric. K of x is k of minus x, and that's all for all x in R and all x in R. And the third property is it needs to integrate to 1. Then the kernel density estimate for f of x with, it's called a kernel with kernel k, is given by f hat h of x equals 1 over n sum I from 1 to n kh of x minus xi for all x in R. And here I use the notation I introduced earlier, so kh here is the rescaled version of k. And on this page, when we still were coming from histograms, we were rescaling that function. But here we are rescaling whatever kernel we are given. Good. So that is the object we will be studying in this module. And to conclude here, I just want to mention a few things. So first, these three conditions, they make a function a kernel. So these conditions hold if and only if k is called a kernel or sometimes a kernel function. And if you check the literature, there is some freedom, so everybody needs condition 3. But 1 and 2 are not really required. They are just there because they make sense. Because first, there is no good reason to plug in an asymmetric estimate. But on the other hand, nothing really goes wrong if you plug in an asymmetric estimate. So that's kind of a good to have thing. Many people, many authors require that. But I doubt very much we are ever going to use that in this module. So I leave it here just because it's commonly used and it's kind of tidy. But if that ever causes problems, I think you can drop it. And this one here, that's a bit more funny. That seems kind of obvious we want that because that we add up these functions to get a density f hat, and densities are always positive. But it turns out there is sometimes reasons where it may make sense to drop this, and you lose this, then you lose this property that the approximation to the density is positive, so your approximation is not a density itself sometimes. but you gain other properties, like sometimes you get faster conversions also. So some authors leave out that. So here we are using all three, but just to repeat myself, the third one is the really essential one, and the others, there is some wiggle room to maybe not require them for a kernel. Good, so this is it for that video, and I will pick things up in the next lecture next week, where we'll start studying the properties of these kernel density estimates. The immediate question, for example, is how good are these estimators? How close are they to the truth? That kind of thing. So, and that concludes our video, second video for this week. And now what is left to do for you is to go back to the notes and read through the notes again carefully to pick up all the details, some of which I've left out in this video, and I'll see you again next week when I release the next batch of notes and videos. Thank you and bye bye.